Hello everyone. We're going to return to the world of painting tonight. In this video, I'm going to tell you about Rembrandt and why he is regarded as one of the most important figures in the history of painting and visual arts. We will take a look at several of his works, especially one of the most famous, The Night Watch, and we will try to understand what makes Rembrandt so special. Because this may not be obvious at first sight. If we take a quick look at several of his paintings, we see a series of generally dark compositions. The colors are mainly ochre, brown, and more often than not, they look a bit faded, muddy almost. There is not much here that evokes an explosion of creative genius or extraordinary visions. To some, it may even look a bit dull. But this is just the surface, just at first sight. We're going to slow down, take our time to examine the look of these characters, and sometimes even Rembrandt's look himself in his self-portraits. We're going to learn about his creative process and his life, and discover that just beneath this surface, there is a hidden world, an extraordinarily modern, innovative, and deeply human artistic experience that just waits to be understood. So let's take the Night Watch as the starting point of our exploration journey. This painting is from 1642, almost four centuries ago. It depicts a company of arquebusiers, and it was a commission made to Rembrandt by a company of militia guards from Amsterdam to represent them, led by their captain, a man called Frans Banning Cooke. The Night Watch is the name given to the painting in the 18th century, because it was already rather dark initially, and on top of this, it was coated with a dark varnish. The varnish was removed, but much later, in the 20th century. This scene is actually supposed to be a day scene. And for contemporaries, the things that were the most surprising when looking at this gallery of portraits were, first, its size. Every character is almost life-size. Then the stark contrast between light and darkness. And finally, the motion in it. There had been many paintings of militia groups before, but none like this one. It looks a bit messy at first, but this chaos is well thought out and organized. The weapons or the flagpoles create parallel lines that radiate from the center, made of the company's leader and his lieutenant. But movement is not only within the frame, it also goes towards the viewer. Look at the hand of Frans Banning Cooke. He seems to be as much showing a direction to the company as he seems to be inviting you, the viewer, to join the scene. The abundance of motion, action, everywhere in the picture, and the drama injected into what was just a commissioned group portrait makes it really stand out from the genre. But it is difficult to create a picture with plenty of motion everywhere and at the same time keep a sense of unity. This is what Rembrandt achieves by turning the two central characters into the cornerstone of the composition. Everything revolves around them, and the action radiates from them. If you close your eyes just for a second and look again, the captain and his lieutenant seem to emerge from the rest of the painting. They are clearly at the foreground, but they are not bigger than other characters, and there are no perspective lines in the composition that create perspective, a sense of depth. They look closer to us because of the definition of their faces and clothes. The closer to the forefront, the most defined the lines are, and characters behind lose definition. They are blurred as they are more distant. Like in a film, this painting mimics depth of field with this technique. Another thing that creates drama in this picture is the stark contrast between shadows and light. This way of accentuating contrast to create drama or a theatrical effect in what is supposed to be a day scene is called chiaroscuro. Rembrandt did not invent it. The painter that made chiaroscuro come to prominence was an Italian painter, Caravaggio. Most of Caravaggio's works were violently lighted, and this powerful light contrasting with the darkness tends to freeze the action at a dramatic moment, to exacerbate the tension. When chiaroscuro becomes extreme, it is sometimes called tenebrism, a style that lets the biggest part of a scene in the dark, and where only the most significant details are lighted. But the use of chiaroscuro by Rembrandt is very different from Caravaggio's. In Rembrandt's work, the contrast is much softer. Light creates a halo. And returning again to our picture, there are two halos of light that frame the captain. One is the lieutenant on the right, and the other is this little girl. This girl is a mystery. There is no obvious reason to her presence. Her face is very probably the face of Rembrandt's wife, Saskia. We'll come back to this later. But who are these people, and what was a militia in 17th century Amsterdam? Let's make a quick history parenthesis. As you may know, the Netherlands took their independence from the rule of the Habsburgs from the 16th century. Starting in 1568, so that's about 80 years before the Night Watch was painted, a revolt erupted in the provinces that are nowadays Luxembourg, Belgium, and the Netherlands. They revolted against their king, Philip II of Spain. Philip II had inherited the huge Spanish Empire in Europe and in the Americas. And these revolted provinces were a part of it. This revolt started a very long war called the 80 Years' War, or Dutch War of Independence. At the start, Philip II lost almost all of them to the rebellion, then deployed his armies and regained control of almost everything. But the northern provinces that correspond roughly to the Netherlands today continued their resistance. After 40 years of fighting, the Dutch Republic was finally recognized by Spain and other European powers. But the fighting resumed later as part of the 30 Years' War in Europe, and it ended only in 1648 with a victorious outcome for the Dutch. During these decades of war, especially the second half of the 16th century, militias of bourgeois had been created in Dutch cities to defend them and maintain order. They were funded by wealthy bourgeois. But in the 17th century, the territory of the Dutch Republic was no longer threatened directly, so these defense militias lost their mainly military reason to be and became like social clubs, gentlemen clubs in a sense, for men from the good society. Only people who could pay for their uniform and equipment were allowed inside the club. It worked by cooptation, so these companies had only relatively wealthy, well-to-do members. And to decorate their headquarters, their clubhouse in a sense, they often commissioned paintings that represented the whole company. There was money for it, because from the beginning of the 17th century, once the Dutch Republic was established and its territory no longer threatened, its economy boomed, in particular thanks to international trade. Dutch merchants were very enterprising, and they established commercial routes to India, the Far East, America, South Africa. Local industry was also very active, and at the beginning of the 17th century, Amsterdam turned into the world's busiest trade and financial center, and remained so for a few decades. This period is called the Dutch Golden Age, and when it comes to the arts, it left a considerable heritage in painting in particular, with names like Rembrandt, Vermeer, Van Dyck, or Frans Hals. This Dutch Golden Age lasted until 1672, which is remembered in Dutch history as the disaster year, the Rampjaar, when France and England simultaneously attacked the Dutch Republic that they wanted to remove from its spot. The Republic survived as an independent country, but Amsterdam would no longer be the prominent center it had been during much of the 17th century. When the Night Watch was painted in 1642, we were just in the middle of the Dutch Golden Age. But if we want to understand what makes Rembrandt special, we need to take a closer look at the surface of the canvas. This painting looks perfectly realistic from far. But the closer we look, the rougher the textures and touches of color. This gives us an insight into Rembrandt's painting technique. Rembrandt does not just spread paint over a canvas. He literally sculpts it. Look at the hair in one of his early self-portraits. The locks appear because he removed the white layer before it dried to let the darker underlayer appear. In many parts, Rembrandt doesn't use brushes only. He removes paint with the other tip of his brush. He paints with his fingers. He uses a small trowel to apply paint. So he modeled the image he wanted to represent. From close, the paintings are thick and the surface is not smooth or slick. It is rough and dimensional. He was not the first painter ever to do this in European art. Recently, in another video about Venice, I told you about the Venetian school, and in particular about Titian, who also applied paint with his fingers. But Rembrandt pushed this much further. And this was against the academic rules of his time. So he got critiqued for this. And many art collectors or more academic painters disliked this style that they found rough and polished. He was also criticized for the darkness of his works, whereas a large part of the Dutch painting production was more colorful and in a sense more classical. But this way of sculpting images and also often leaving less important parts of the canvas unfinished was not a stunt to do things differently from others. It was certainly influenced by Rembrandt's other visual works, because he was not only a painter, he also left hundreds of drawings and engravings. But this is not the main reason. Rembrandt did not just paint to do something beautiful, decorative, commercially successful, or to showcase his talent. His entire body of work reveals that he was trying to dig below the surface and catch emotions, states of mind, including his. He tried to use painting to capture singular moments and a form of truth that his art could reveal. To understand this, look at these other paintings. Rembrandt produced more than 60 self-portraits over 40 years. Through this, he documented his aging from young, disheveled and ambitious man to a mature and successful painter at the height of his success, to elder, an old man. It is hard to deny the honesty and candor that these portraits communicate. There is a life and a humanity in the eyes and the facial characteristics of each of these self-portraits that had probably never been pictured like this before. Despite the absence of polish, these self-portraits could make you think of photographic headshots for their liveliness, their sincerity and the depth in the look. Rembrandt doesn't care for the embellishment of reality, and in a sense he sees it as an artifice that takes us away from the truth. He's looking for the fixation, the capture of emotion, of truth, of a fleeting moment, or a state of mind. Now, this is a painting called The Jewish Bride, one of his latest, and it is obvious what his intention is in it. It shows a couple in front of an undefined background, in a moment of communion, tenderness, and maybe even bliss. All the lines are curved, from the arms and the sleeves to the shoulders and the inclination of their heads. The man has a protective attitude, and the woman expresses her consent by gently touching his hand on her chest. Each of them is absorbed in the moment and leaves this moment in their own minds. They abandon themselves to their feelings and meditate. This is another slightly earlier painting commissioned by the Drapers Guild of Amsterdam. So it represents the syndics of this guild. The clothes are black and severe because this was how people were dressed. But there is nothing threatening nor harsh in the appearance of these men. They look at us as if we just entered the room. All the looks converge towards the viewer and invite us inside the scene. This captures a particular short moment of curiosity from them, which makes them collectively come to life. And this quest for human emotions and the labyrinth of human mind started early in Rembrandt's career. This is yet another painting called The Philosopher in Meditation, and it is from 1632, 30 years before the last paintings we looked at, and 10 years before the Night Watch. We don't know the original title of this work, so it is hard to read and may be opened to multiple interpretations. But there is no doubt it is deeply introspective. An old man is sitting near a window from which natural light enters. There is another artificial source of light at the bottom right with a fire. Immediately after the man that seems to be waiting or meditating, the composition and the contrast of light and shadow draw our attention to the circular staircase. That staircase could be the materialization of the spiraling mind of the man, the materialization of his thinking, his thought process, or a symbol of the mysteries and depth of the human mind. It also looks like an hourglass, so it could be an invitation to think about the passing of time and nostalgia or melancholy, a feeling Rembrandt was no stranger to. Because all these emotions he tried to capture in images, he drew from his own life. Rembrandt had a man's life, with ups and downs, more downs towards the end of his life. He found love with his wife, but lost her after 10 years. He had a son, Titus, that he often painted, and he lost him too. Rembrandt came from a middle-class family from the city of Leiden in the Netherlands. He received a solid education and showed talent early for drawing and painting. His parents let him choose this path for a career, and after attracting the attention of an important buyer, he could move his workshop to Amsterdam. He became a successful painter in Amsterdam, working for clients that appreciated the liveliness of his portraits, even though his style of painting was not conventional. He married a girl from a wealthy family, Saskia, and everything indicates this was a happy marriage, a marriage of love. And with his successful career and wealthy wife, he could live a comfortable life in the 1630s. He bought a big house in Amsterdam and collected art and curiosities. Saskia served as a model in many paintings, and these years were probably the happiest in his personal life. They had their son, Titus, in 1641, but Saskia fell ill and died the following year. The same year, 1642, the night watch was completed. The girl in the group portrait has the face of Saskia, and she was dying when he painted her. Was he trying to paint her one last time? We don't know, but she looks like an angel in this halo of light. So she died in 1642, and then his life went downhill from there. Even though he never stopped painting and receiving commissions, but he was less successful. He had constant financial problems, and he lost his treasured collections to his creditors. His son had poor health and reached adulthood, but died before him. In his latest years, Rembrandt was relatively poor and a bit lonely. His fame as a painter had decreased, even though he was never forgotten, and this shows in the disenchanted feel of his last self-portraits. He died in 1669, at 63. When Rembrandt died, his reputation beyond the Dutch Republic was already well established, especially thanks to his prints. He was always considered a master of painting, but his reputation grew even more in the 19th century because of his innovative technique, his success out of the academic rules. He was highly regarded by the Impressionists, for example, for that reason, and also for his quest of a human reality, his empathy for the human condition, long before these became important concerns inside the world of art. The more you know about Rembrandt's life and his body of work, the harder it is not to like him as a person, for his candor, his empathy, and his artistic quest that he was almost alone in pursuing for his entire life, out of conventions. Rembrandt is a major step in the invention of what a modern artist is considered to be today. Someone looking for a form of truth or revelation beyond the visible, and exploring his own inner life with all the egotism it can imply. But he did it so graciously and with so much empathy that he always remains relatable and familiar somehow. If anything, his works that are now almost 4 centuries old inform us that the human condition was not that different 15 or 20 generations ago. So this is all for today. I'll put a link to my playlist about art if you want to see more videos about paintings. Thank you very much for accompanying me tonight, and see you soon for another topic.